Hey folks, this is Patrick with Last Born in the Wilderness.
And I'm Rob Simons, and I'm with this show Moving Forward on the Progressive Radio Network.
Yeah, this is our first time doing a joint interview together. We've spoken previously on the podcast, but this is the first time that we've met in person, and we had the really great fortune to interview journalist Dahr Jamail. He is the author of The End of Ice, Bearing Witness and Finding Meaning in the Path of Climate Disruption.
You can also find his work on Truthout, which he does regular climate dispatches, and as well as just other environmental issues that are happening in the United States.
Right. And if you want to learn more about Dahr's work, you can go to dahrjamail.net. All of these things are going to be in the description of our respective episodes that we release for both of our shows. So I just thought it would be just good to give a little bit of a layout of what was just discussed with Dahr. As I mentioned, he just released this excellent book less than a week ago, I believe, at the recording of this interview. We had a little over an hour-long conversation with him about some of the themes that he brings up in this book. You know, what were some major points that you think were brought up in this interview, Rob?
I think one thing that we got behind Dahr the human and Dahr the person and Dahr getting personal, which is now what his writing's shifting to, which I was really happy with.
Yeah. We get into obviously some of the science that he brings up in this work regarding abrupt climate disruption. But, you know, we had a really, I think, very profound, moving, I think, discussion about what it means to be alive right now. What does it mean to carry this information with you? Now that the climate is changing at an accelerating rate in a nonlinear fashion, how do we proceed in this time that we're in? There's not really an easy answer to that, but I mean, we attempt to get at some of those points in this. You know, how do we each individually, and especially Dahr, doing the work that he's done with this book, how did he approach the grief and the despair and the anger and the questions that come up in the face of this information? I think that anybody who's attracted to this work is going to have.
And I think too, you know, a lot of people that are going to be listening to this are already into the climate science, and they've read all the science, and they know where the areas of concern are when it comes to the environment. But one thing that's interesting about this book is that he details his personal journey of connecting with nature along the way of studying the environment. And I think we captured that pretty well.
I think so, too. I think, you know, we both look up to Dahr. You know, we're great admirers of his work and his courage in being able to articulate and to write about something that is very difficult to even get at. I mean, I think most people that are coming at this information, at least when they at first come across it, are going to be somewhat alienated. And I think now that more and more people are waking up to this information, this is really the shift that we need to get. The shift that is currently underway for a lot of people is finding the others. Finding other people like Rob and I have found each other through our work that we've done, and of course finding Dahr's work and all the other people that we have been very fortunate in getting to know as a result of putting out our voices, our work into the world with Rob, your amazing writings you do for Counterpunch, and just my podcast here, and of course with your show on PRN. We've had the great fortune of meeting some incredibly beautiful human beings that are grappling with the same very deep questions that come up when we look at the information that, say, Dahr is bringing up and others as well. Another point I want to say real quick is that, you know, Dahr talks about his experience of talking with scientists from all over the world, completely different bioregions, whether it's all the way up in Alaska or down in the Amazon forest. He also mentioned in the talk last night at Powell's Books that we went to the work that scientists are doing at the coral reefs down and off of the coast of Australia. You know, there's massive changes underway, and as scientists are trying to grapple with these big questions, they're personally dealing with these as well. So I think that those points were really brought up in this discussion.
And one thing too with Dahr, with you, is that, and what I try to do with my show is try to offer people a way to move forward. And I think we really addressed that. And just not making it such a, even the smallest action is a big action. I think that was addressed too. I think people enjoy that. And, you know, just a shifting of priorities. I think we tried to all touch on how our priorities in life have shifted after we found out this information. So I hope that anyone who listens to this, they can think about what they're doing with their life, what they've done, and maybe make some changes for them to put them in a better place with what's going to be happening in the future.
I think one thing that is so profoundly sad in this discussion, and what we discussed regarding all of these catastrophic changes that are underway right now, is learning how to say goodbye to these places. That is really the sacred work that Dahr is asking of us. And what I think, if we could point to any message that climate change is asking us as individuals and as a collective, is how do we grow up and how do we learn to take responsibility for the time that we're in? Not to put blame on any particular person or anything in particular, but it's just growing up as a species, growing up as a culture, and growing up as individuals, and facing this information on its own terms. That is the very unique and difficult challenge that has been presented to us. And Dahr, if there's anybody out there that is able to communicate this information, it's Dahr Jamail. He does such an amazing job doing that. So it was really a great honor for both of us, not only to meet each other finally. We know we're both here in Portland, Oregon. We were able to have Dahr come over and do this interview with us, but obviously meeting each other, but also having the opportunity to meet someone like Dahr. It was really a beautiful experience, and I'm so happy that we both can share this with the world. So thank you for listening and watching.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for all the support that you've provided us over. I've been doing this the past year and a half. I know you've been doing it for a lot longer. So
a little bit.
Yeah. So, yeah. Thank you to everyone that listens, and hopefully you can take some of what Dahr says and spread that message to others in your life.
Yeah. And I'll show this book one more time, The End of Ice. It is really worth picking up. Again, it's probably at every major bookstore at this point, but you can, of course, buy it at the publisher's website and other, obviously, larger websites. You could probably find this book and purchase a copy there. I'll put links to Dahr's website, his Truthout profile, where you can read his updates on climate and other happenings in politics and other current events at Truthout. I'll put a link to all of that, and you'll obviously be doing the same down in the description of each of our respective releases of this episode. So, Rob, it's been a great pleasure to have this time to do this joint interview.
It's been surreal, and I'm glad that we made it happen.
It's a beautiful thing. So thank you all for tuning in. And here's our joint interview with Dahr Jamail. So I just want to first thank you, Dahr, for doing this. We've been planning this for a couple months maybe at this point. I don't know. I think we talked about this maybe with the last interview we did with the live podcast that I did back at the end of October. And Rob, of course, we've been wanting to meet. And then, of course, figuring this all out has been an interesting process. But I'm really happy that we're all sitting in the same room together. It's slightly surreal when you read somebody's work for, again, years, as we were saying before this, that we've been reading your work for years. I've talked to Rob previously on the podcast. I've talked to you. So just hearing your voice. Then last night we saw you were at Powell's Books. You did a book release there. You signed some books. You did a talk. It was a really powerful talk. I could feel the energy in the room as everything you went over, the scientific information and things that you've explored in your book, traveling around the world, observing abrupt climate disruption in real time, and talking with scientists about it. I could really feel that energy. Like I said before, you're so good at communicating those ideas and those feelings that, again, it's a great pleasure. It's a great honor that all of us could be sitting here today. And with this little dog here as well.
Our emotional support.
Emotional.
There you go.
Yeah. Could you speak in the microphone one more time?
Yeah.
Okay.
Is that coming through?
It's coming through.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Just want to make sure. Sorry. One more time.
Yeah. Dahr talking with you here. Hopefully that's coming through all right.
Yep. Okay. All right. Okay. Just want to make sure. That would suck.
Yeah. No, I've done that. Yeah, I understand.
I've That's like my worst fear. I don't know if you've heard of Stephen Jenkinson before.
He's in my book.
He's in your book. Oh, yeah. That's beautiful. I'm excited. I haven't gotten through yet. I just bought your book last night. But Stephen Jenkinson, when I spoke with him for the first time earlier last year, I had an audio glitch. His audio was completely lost. And this like feeling just like, oh shit.
I was interviewing the president of Lebanon once during the Israel-Lebanon war in 06, and literally in person, and was like 2/3 of the way through the interview and looked down and it wasn't on. It wasn't recorded. Yes. So I understand. Always good to check.
Well, that's worse.
Yeah. No, I don't know.
Yeah.
Jenkinson's
amazing. Interview. I mean, like when I talked to him the first time, I mean, there was definitely a moment where I'm like, I don't know how to proceed. You stunned me with whatever you said. Somehow the way you articulated those thoughts and those feelings just stunned me. So yeah. Anyway, so everything's working. So that's good. But yeah, you know, last night you really touched on some really beautiful topics and the difficulty of communicating those ideas, I imagine. I just want to know, how are you feeling? I know you've been traveling a little bit talking about this book. It just came out last week. You are speaking on behalf of, I think, so many scientists, so many people that are becoming aware of this information. I think they often feel alienated at first, like I've felt. I'm sure Rob, you felt that way as well.
Absolutely.
And you, I'm sure there's that initial alienation that comes because you feel, am I crazy?
Mm-hmm. Well, the name of your podcast is perfect for that.
Yeah. Yeah. It's, I guess, intentionally a little ambiguous, but you know, people kind of get that feeling from the title of it. And so I'm glad that, yeah. So I guess just like, how are you doing personally? How are you doing with conveying this information to, I think, a wider audience than I think most people have been able to do up to this point?
Yeah, I'm feeling a lot of things. Actually, this has been a very, very emotional time for me. And I think it's less to do with the fact that the book's finally out, because this is the end of a multi-year project that has happily consumed my life. And it's been a lot of work, definitely a labor of love. But I think a lot of my feeling comes from just the evolution that the book and the information and the process in it, and coming to terms with the stark reality of these times, coupled with then, I think, the mandated evolution that has to happen for me, and I think for all of us as we go forward now, accepting, you know, living in this climate disrupted world, and you know, the hard realities that are upon us. And also, I think the simultaneous evolution, you know. And so I'm walking around with this constant sadness for the planet. I mean, another huge report comes out literally today about, you know, ramping up of the melting in Greenland, that it's hitting a tipping point soon. And, you know, and all of this, you know, this less than a week ago, the report about the Antarctic, of the melting increasing sixfold since just the 1970s. I mean, now when I hear these things, instead of going into kind of an angry cynicism and a self-righteousness of, see, I told you so, it's really, I feel sadness for the planet, and I feel sadness for all of us, you know, about what. So it's really a mixed feeling of that. And then also, of course, relief now that the book is out. And I am happy to have this platform to get this out to a much, much wider audience. And I think people are really hungry for it.
Yeah.
I think when I watched you being interviewed on CBS, it was a great moment. I felt like it was somebody who's one of us is out there speaking. And finally, one of our voices is being on mainstream media, which was unbelievable to me.
Me too.
And one thing I noticed in your writings now is you're getting much more personal about your story, how you're dealing with it, how we need to deal with it, as opposed to just spitting out the science and, you know, hey, that's it. And one thing you said that I listened to a recent interview is you said that you thought humans aren't connected to nature like we used to be. What do you think has caused us to fracture this connection?
I think it's really a direct symptom of corporate capitalism and this consumer-based society and really the entire power structure now of the West that is based on global capitalism, of otherizing nature, of treating nature as a resource or a slave, or something that we can just take and take and take. And that really is the dominant mindset of capitalism, is exploitation. And treating the earth from which we came, of which we are 100% reliant, as this other, is suicidal. And so I think that that's where the disconnect fundamentally came, because indigenous cultures, you know, everything is sacred. Everything, every rock, every blade of grass, every tree. If you're going to take an animal to eat, you need to pray first, and then you're going to pray over and thank the animal for giving you its life so that you can continue, you know, that kind of relationship with nature, you know, of all my relations, as we hear, and versus this corporate capitalism, you know, nature's out there, we're here. We have to be afraid of nature. We have to exploit it. And so there's this disconnect, and in the process, we lose the direct connection to the planet, i.e., which I think is the same thing of losing a direct connection literally to ourselves.
I think that's so important that your book, it seems to outline not only what is happening all over the world, but also how you're connecting with nature in the meantime. And that's such an important message for people to hear.
And I hope that, I mean, my one hope of this book is that when people read it, if nothing else, I want people to just go reconnect in with nature. If nothing else happens from reading the book except that, then I'll feel like it was 100% worth it and I've done the job.
Right. You know, something that I've kind of realized by exploring this concept of climate change is it's a thread. It's not, it's like, I think when you try to deal with climate change within the context of our culture and our cultural value systems, we tend to not approach it in the appropriate way, which is to say that often people want to engineer our way out of this crisis, right? It's always like, okay, so a technological fix is going to come into play at some point. Let's try to fund that. Let's get all of our resources behind that. Maybe some billionaire in Silicon Valley is going to figure something out. And I always feel like that is way out, that is fits within the logic of this exploitive system that you're discussing. And that's to me, like, the if there's a lesson that could be drawn from this extremely tragic process that's unfolding right now, that's really been over the course of maybe hundreds or even thousands of years. And that's kind of the trip, is that once you start, okay, why is this happening? And that's such a huge question. It's not just carbon emissions. We can look at all of the science behind it, and that is absolutely 100% important to getting your foot in the door, because then you can conceptualize it and understand it on that level. But then there's this other completely deeper, much more difficult level that, again, I think our culture gets in the way of often, which is to understand, like, how did we build a society and a culture that was so messed up and so in so many ways. I mean, and it's not just with our environment. I think it's a reflection of what's happening internally. You know, when my wife and I were driving up to Boise to fly here, we were having this discussion about intergenerational trauma. Sorry, I'm kind of getting off track slightly. But I'm thinking about all the various ways in which our culture has been built on all these faulty premises. And maybe there's values that we can come out of that are good. You know, it isn't like we can necessarily throw everything out with the water or whatever. But it seems to me that what climate change and this whole crisis is asking of us, the whole ecological crisis globally, is asking us something that is so deep and so profound. And my fear, what makes me so sad, is I don't know if most people, are going to come to that realization. And that's what scares me mostly. It's not even that I'm worried about the extinction. I think that may or may not happen. That's almost out of our hands at this point. What we can choose to do is to figure out how do we live beautifully in the time that we have. And it's going to be really hard to do that when we have nuclear power plants along every coast in the United States and around the world. We have ridiculous political institutions and a corporate capitalist mindset that runs the economy. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's so overwhelming. And this podcast has been almost a blessing and a curse in that way.
I understand. I feel exactly the same about my climate writing online and working on this book. And it's I think what you just articulated is evidence of kind of this simultaneous world living that I think all of us have to engage in now. That, you know, here we are sitting here in a comfortable place having this conversation. It's warm, we're dry, we have our needs met right now, with the simultaneous knowledge that already there's people living on coasts that are having to leave. They're flooding. Climate change is upon them. Mm-hmm. If you lived in Paradise, California, places where you've already lost everything, like they're already living in the climate disrupted future that the rest of us who haven't experienced a direct extreme weather event that's completely altered our lives, we haven't gotten there yet. So for us, there's still this, and for a lot of the culture, there's still this, well, it's not here yet, it's in the future, it's out there. And yet for increasing numbers of people around the world, these numbers are increasing daily, it's here. They're living in what we perceive to be this future. And yet at the same time, those of us that have watched this coming and really understand it deeply, I feel like we're getting a chance to kind of emotionally process it. Like we're on borrowed time and we're getting to let this sink in before these extreme weather events hit us. And mm-hmm. and in some sense, you know, in my case, for example, even in the Pacific Northwest with the smoke in the summers from the wildfires, the acidifying oceans that's already hitting the shellfish industries up here, you know, it is already starting to happen. And it's, how do you live in all these worlds simultaneously, you know? And then, you know, and the reality is, you know, I will leave this interview and get in my car and drive back home. Yeah. And, you know, this is quite the psychological tightroping that I think all of us have to live in. And, you know, for me, it forces the issue of evolve, you know, like spiritually I have to evolve and constantly be talking to people about what's going on and processing grief and sharing it and laughing and crying and understanding that, yeah, this is a really, truly mad time to be on the planet. I can't imagine a more intense time to be on this planet than right now.
Yeah.
Well, and it seems like, too, you know, a lot of people, they call this the Anthropocene. And I know in your writings, you use the term ACD, anthropogenic climate disruption. And it's all this definition of, well, what does the Anthropocene mean? And what do we do in this time? And I feel like this is an age where we're going to have to learn to say goodbye. And we are going to have to get out in nature to say goodbye properly. And it was a talk you were interviewed on Counterpunch Radio a couple months back. And I remember you were wondering aloud, are there people that are making calculated decisions on where to move based off of what's happening with climate change? And I'm one of those people who did. I lived in Florida, and after Hurricane Irma came, it just missed me, and me and my wife looked at each other and said, never again. And we moved out here, and I was almost in denial that this was a global situation. I came out here, and you know, you see pictures of Oregon. I'd never really been. It's beautiful, but the silence was deafening. I haven't connected with wildlife here yet like I did in Florida. But you got to find the silver linings. Like you talked about last night when you were diving the Great Barrier Reef, there's areas where it's bleached, but there's areas where it's not. And the one silver lining I found so far is there's this hill called Mimalus Hills. It's about 60 miles down. And in the spring, there's just flowers everywhere. And you see bees everywhere pollinating the flowers. It's just beautiful. And if we're aware of these things, we're going to be able to say goodbye to that properly. So do you feel like you've been able to do that? That this book has kind of chronicled those moments for you?
I do. I feel like the book provided me with this extraordinary privilege of getting to go to these amazing places in the world, like the Amazon, the Great Barrier Reef, Glacier National Park, Utqiagvik, Alaska, formerly known as Barrow, all these really incredible places that are changing before our very eyes. And in a lot of ways, many of them are going away. I mean, like there is no question that the entirety of South Florida will be underwater well before I die. No question. You know, if you look at what's happening already, the melting of Greenland and the Antarctic and going to these places, fully cognizant of all the science and what's happening and what's projected, and knowing that no government on the earth is reacting the way it should be in the face of this crisis. And so a lot of these places, like when I was at the Great Barrier Reef, I really felt like, you know, I don't see myself coming back here. I don't know when it's going to happen. I intend to phase out flying altogether. And I literally had this experience where I felt like I was saying goodbye to the reef. And I wrote about that in the book. And I feel like that's a tremendous pleasure. And then at the same time, again, here's like, how many worlds do we need to try to live in at the same simultaneously? Also appreciating the beauty and just being with it, you know, because it's still here. It's still here. And we don't know when it will go away completely. In the case of the Great Barrier Reef, it looks like it's single digit years at this point for sure. Well, for sure in quotes, it certainly looks that way. But it's still here. And so for me, when I'm writing a hard article and about the climate and I get overwhelmed and I can step outside of my house and it's surrounded by a bunch of big Doug firs and hemlocks and cedars and just be with the trees and just find solace in that. Like, they're still here and I'm still here, you know? And just like I've been saying now on tour, what's coming up, it's like, well, if you're still here, I can still be here, you know? And that's also a reason to keep doing whatever I can, regardless of the outlook of how bleak it is, how intensely it feels like we're doomed at times, that regardless, I still feel morally obliged to do everything I can to try to help take care of the planet. Because we don't know for sure what's going to happen. And even if we did, I would still get up and try to do the right thing simply because, you know, I want to go out on my feet and I want to have dignity and I want to be in right relations with the planet.
I've tried to use sports terms in my writing to try to get people to connect to that. And one term I used in regards to this situation is that we need to be gunslingers. You know, when you think of someone who's like, for football, he's a quarterback, he's a gunslinger, he'll take these big chances to win the game. And to me, the game we're trying to win right now is a little bit more time, with nature. And, you know, maybe it does go away and for sure there's nothing we can control. But if we were to be gunslingers with the environment and with the planet in mind, maybe we'd have a little bit more time with some of this stuff and not neglect it like we have. That's the painful part.
Yeah. I recently interviewed a couple people, Will Falk, who's an environmental activist and a lawyer, a former lawyer. I think he's still a lawyer technically. But he talked about his time visiting the Unist'ot'en camp in the Wet'suwet'en nation up in so-called British Columbia. And his experience of being on that land, helping build a bunkhouse, which is a part of the Unist'ot'en camp now. And then I also interviewed Dr. Carla Tate, who I think she's program director of the Indigenous Healing Center at the Unist'ot'en camp. So she's a member of that nation. And, you know, I'm pretty sure that Will Falk and I'm pretty sure Carla Tate and all these people that are living on that territory that are fighting, you know, standing in the way of the pipeline project up in that region. And the recent breaching of territory that happened with the Canadian Mounted Police, that all those people are fully aware, I imagine, on some level of what's happening on the planet on a global scale. But they still see the sacredness of what they've been able to protect. They see the value of the non-human life that exists in that territory. And what would happen if this pipeline was built? I mean, even if in the best case scenario there were no spills, let's say there was no leaks, nothing, it would still be an ecologically devastating project on that alone. And they're willing to put their bodies in the way. And they built structures in the way. And they had that camp, while it is, you know, partly there to stand in the way of this pipeline project, these various proposed pipelines. They also built this Indigenous Healing Center, which is trying to undo generations of colonialism in Canada. That work is so beautiful. And even in the face of all this, you like say, well, what's the point? You know, there's this sort of, I think, almost narcissistic or something. I don't know what the right word would be for it. But this sense of like, well, we're fucked. So now what? You know, let's just try to live the best we can hedonistically. And that's not what you and several other people we could probably name are asking. It says this information, while it's devastating, it induces sadness and grief and anger. That's not the mature response. Right. And we can look to Indigenous cultures, not to like put them on this, you know, pedestal, like to idealize them, but to look to other cultures that have a much more healthy culture, much more healthy way of viewing their relationship with the natural world. And even in the face of this, they're acting with dignity and maturity. And that to me is what makes me so viscerally angry when I see shit like that happen in Canada, where they're trying to still build these pipelines. I'm like, how insane. I'm sorry. I just get mad thinking about it. And that's why I really wanted to cover that subject on the podcast. So anyway, I'll hand it over to you. But like, you know, what did you learn in your travels in various cultures, various societies, different contexts of how they're grappling with this information?
That's actually very well put, Patrick. And one of the people I met while working on this book, and he's in my last chapter, is Stan Rushworth. He's a teacher, an author, a healer, and an elder of Cherokee descent. And he pointed out to me in response to that point that in the West, you know, we have this idea of human rights. What are my rights? And in indigenous cultures, they have moral obligations to future generations and to Earth. And so as we grow up and mature and continue to evolve, I think that should, at least in theory, deepen our commitment to those two moral obligations. And it really comes down to, and this is something that he talks about as well in my book, is how do I choose to comport myself during this time? That even if everything is lost, and if absolutely humans are going extinct, and let's, you know, all the worst case scenarios come true, that doesn't change the fact that I still want to keep taking care and being a steward of land where I live, of different species, and still trying to do the right thing and help in any way that I can. It's simply how I want to go out. And it's simply how I want to live my life, however long I have. And the other piece of that, the way I explain it, is pretend that it's 30 years from now. And let's say Rob's child comes up to me and says, wow, you were on the planet in 2019 and there was still Arctic sea ice and there were still glaciers in the lower 48. And there was, you know, the Amazon was still largely intact and there was all this. And now most of that, if not all of it's gone. And you knew all this was coming. What did you do in 2019? I want to be able to say I effing did everything that I could, you know, and part of that's selfish so that I can cover my own ass. But then part of it is selfless. It's, you know what, you know, I would put my body down if it was going to save a couple of other species. Mm-hmm. And I want to live my life in a way that shows that my priority is living in right relation to the earth. And you know, this book was a profound experience of bringing people like Stan into my life to give me that information literally as I was writing the conclusion, because I had no idea how to conclude this book with the devastating science that's in it. I had no idea. And then the earth brought into my life this extremely wise, intelligent, articulate elder who then also brought in a bunch of very important indigenous stories as well as his own words to help me in the book, which has essentially been then this touch point from which now I'm in this new place, you know, and you know, I'm trying to live into this new way of being that was created by literally writing this book.
Yeah. It's, you know, I don't really have many in-person conversations about things like this, which is refreshing. Yeah. to talk about this. And that's personally, like, selfishly, what I think about is that I'm going to be a father now any day. And that's the ultimate challenge is to me, to my son, is what am I going to do to try and like for his generation and for him. And I appreciate everything that you're doing with the book and the journey that you're chronicling to kind of help me through, because I know at the end of the talk last night, you posed a challenge to everybody of where's your spot to connect? Where's your, you know, footprint that you can make? And I think that's something that I'm going to be thinking about a lot here in the next couple of days.
And I think that we're all morally obliged. It keeps coming back to what I keep referring to as a moral obligation to the younger generations and the future generations, that, you know, I'm in a position now where I can help. And I feel like all of us now, the onus is on us to protect them, to educate them, to prepare them, and help them for this extremely challenging time that the world is now in, that's going to get more challenging each day. And I just see that as another layer of this moral obligation, because when I talk about feeling morally obliged to be a steward and help work for the earth, that of course includes all beings, including humans.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I just want to maybe touch on some things that you really get into in the book. Obviously we talked pretty much everything that probably you in spirit that you discuss in the book, but I think that for me, it is difficult to communicate these ideas to a broader public who are unfamiliar with all the things that we're basically discussing. You know, I don't know if we mentioned it already, but you've been on CBS, you were on NPR. You are, I think, as an individual, very well equipped to communicate these ideas to people that are unfamiliar with them. At least maybe they might have a, you know, obviously global warming and climate change is a very, it's a vague concept that I think most people are fairly, at least on some surface level, understand. They get, okay, the climate is changing, or they might be in denial of it. Whatever it is, they have some basic understanding of it. You know, there are concepts within discussing abrupt climate disruption that is, I think, difficult even for people that are totally, read the science, understand it, read your work, read other people's work, they get it. But there are certain concepts that I think psychologically are difficult for human beings, particularly human beings, to wrap their head around often, even scientists, right? And I think that's what kind of creates this dissidence a little bit, this sort of split world thing that you're talking about, because psychologically we on a certain level we understand exponential change. We can understand if we look at it on paper, but then when we see it in real life, we're trying to understand how fast this is coming at us. It's like, oh, I'm still surprised. You know, you said that. I remember in our last interview, you mentioned, you know, you go up to the mountains, of course, and that's a big part of this book. You go to the mountains, is where you find, that's, you always feel called to those places. And you, I can't remember which mountain it was, and I apologize for not remembering it, but you were up at, you were climbing a mountain, you were trying to get some respite from all the information you had been neck deep in. You get up there, and there were these wildfires in the here in the West this past summer. And there was so much smoke, mm-hmm. even where you were at, that you mm-hmm. you know, you were having respiratory issues up in this place that you thought would be kind of untouched by that.
Yeah.
And that's when it hit you again, like, oh, this is this is real. It's that's what's the biggest thing, is when it becomes personal. Mm-hmm. You know, when it becomes something that hits us deeply. So I guess maybe to frame this within a real question for you would be, what are some of the concepts within abrupt climate disruption that are maybe really difficult to communicate to unfamiliar people that are unfamiliar with it?
Well, it's, as you mentioned, it's the nonlinear feedback loops. I mean, it's really, really hard for the human brain to grasp exponential change. And the simplest way to put it, you know, well, first of all, talking about these feedback loops, just square one, the most famous one that I think most people have heard of is that when the Arctic sea ice was intact, the Arctic summer sea ice, it reflected about 95% of the solar radiation back into space. As it thins and melts, more of that radiation is being absorbed by the Arctic Ocean, which then warms faster, which then melts the ice faster, which then reflects less heat, more of it goes into the ocean, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So that's a feedback loop, mm-hmm. positive feedback loop, runaway feedback loop, however you want to phrase it. And a simpler way, the simplest way actually to put that, Dr. Dan Fagry, a USGS research scientist and Glacier National Park, put it that, talking about feedback loops, the more something happens, the more it happens, yeah. which is essentially it. So as the oceans warm, there's more coral bleaching, there's more melting of the Antarctic ice sheets from below, which causes more sea level rise, which then is, you know, if there's higher seas, then it's going to melt more of the ice, which is going to melt faster, which is going to raise the seas, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So, and now at present, some scientists believe that there's as many as over 60 feedback loops that have already been kicked in. We don't know exactly what the number is for sure, but it is something that former NASA scientist James Hansen warned a long time ago that once we hit 1C should have been the limit. If we were serious about really trying to slow down or stop or avert climate catastrophe, he warned quite a few years ago that 1C is the limit. And we have to remember that this 1.5C and this 2C stuff that's been bantered around in the Paris Climate Accords and the IPCC and the UN Environment Program, that these are politically agreed upon goals. These are not based on science. The scientific goal, according to Hansen, was 1C, and we've already passed it. And that's why we already see so many of these feedback loops that have kicked in. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it's the exponential change. That's extremely challenging to communicate to people. I think that's partly, again, it's the psychology of human beings, I think, but it's also the unfortunate fact of how it's been communicated to the public up to this point. I think we have this idea of global warming. This is, okay, the sea levels will slowly rise a little bit at a time. We can adapt and change to those incremental changes. And what you're saying, what others are saying, the changes are so rapid that nothing, not just human beings. I mean, we think we're so clever, you know. That's a mythology of our culture, I think, that we can engineer our way out of these scenarios. But this is the same for all other life on the planet as well, mm-hmm. which takes on, you know, a profound despair when you think that this isn't just about, you know, this is the human-centric quality of a lot of these conversations that people have about abrupt climate change. It's like, we can live without those other life forms. We can figure it out. If we can just figure out how to build a bunker or something for the rich to live in, or, you know, there's this delusional mindset. Like there was an article that came out last year from Douglas Rushkoff, and I interviewed him about it. It was an article called Survival of the Richest or Survival of the Rich. He talked about how he got invited to this private meeting with five very wealthy guys. And they're like, so in this worst case scenario where the event happens, how are we going to make sure that we have security guards to protect us? How are we going to make sure that we have food and blah, blah, blah? And he's like, first of all, you're asking the wrong question. You know, well, you're asking how can we maintain things as they are where you're still on top? And that's just not going to be the equation. You should learn how to live with people, you know, and you know, that's a whole other subject. But, yeah, people are thinking like we can move to New Zealand or we can move to Alaska or we can move to some part of the planet that's going to be less affected by this. And I think that's just not going to work.
Well, and we can. And I'm going to implicate myself in that. I moved to Port Townsend because I looked at the NASA projections for drought, rainfall, et cetera, you know, temperature increases. And Port Townsend was somewhere that, based on those projections, that if I lived to be into my 80s or 90s, I should still be able to grow food year round and have enough water to do it. Oh, okay. Unlike most of the rest of the country. Mm. So that's why I moved up to the north coast of the Olympic Peninsula, because it's going to be one of the better places to live. That said, it's not exempt from these severe impacts like acidification, wildfires, drought, massive influx of climate refugees, whether they're choosing to be, as I would classify myself as one, mm-hmm. Or not. And mm-hmm. and right now, at least, you know, in this bubble of the West Coast of the United States, for a lot of people, there's still this choice.
Yeah.
And but daily, more and more people are losing that choice. And I think ultimately all of us will. The question is just, what does that look like? But you know, I think really getting down to the core of what you were just talking about is that part of the myth of this human supremacist culture of the West is that we're in charge and that we have that we are somehow in charge of what's happening. And we're not, and we never were. And, you know, we're this little thing. We're not God. And nature is so much bigger and more powerful than us. And you know, those of us that go out regularly are reminded of that every time we go out into nature. You know, go stand on a mountain and, you know, right nearby where an avalanche is released. And, mm-hmm. you know, and it's mm-hmm. you're going to get perspective real quick. Or be in a huge, powerful storm in a tent, you know. and remember your right place in things. And instead, this idea that, you know, I think these examples of like moving to New Zealand and building a bunker and having guards and food stores and ways to have clean air and water and all this, that's just like this end stage of running that dead, old, dated program out to the end of, you know, I'm going to stay in control to the very end in my bunker. It's like, well, yeah, enjoy your canned beans when there's no air to breathe, you know, and it's, that's really going to be the end stage of that, as opposed to what we were talking about earlier is, you know, I'd rather go out and be with nature. And when it's time to go, it's time to go, but I'm not going to go inside some bunker eating canned beans.
Does that seem worth it at that point?
Well, we're definitely going to move to where you are. We're going to start a commune and we're just going to live off the land. I think this is a great thing. I think we can do this.
Yeah, I mean, I'm only a couple more hours north. I'm in.
Yeah, we'll make it work.
Yeah. Come on up. Got a big garden going.
One thing I'm wondering, and it's really a question for both of you, because, you know, I just write and do a radio show. I haven't gone out in public and given a talk like both of you have. And this, how do we communicate? Do you think that when we communicate these things, it taps into our fear of the unknown, like the fear of death? Mm-hmm. We don't know what that's going to do to us. This mystery of, we don't know how to do as much as we used to. A couple hundred years ago, we had to take care of ourselves a lot more. We're now, I feel like, with capitalism, has made us specialists. Like, how would I survive if there's no power, no water? That unknown. Do you think that that kind of is a barrier that is hard to get over with some people?
Well, this is specifically why I brought Stephen Jenkinson also into my last chapter. And for those who aren't aware of him, you it'd be a great time to become acquainted with his work. Yeah. Author, storyteller, musician, speaker, brilliant thinker and feeler. And he's a guy who worked in the palliative care industry for decades, helping people die. And he talks and writes very articulately about this Western culture's complete denial of death. You know, like the medical system, for example, being set up to, we're not going to question whether we should or should not keep someone who's 89 and riddled with cancer and writhing in pain alive as long as possible. That's just what we're going to do because we can't let them die. And there's this phobia of death. And I think that that's driving a lot of the denialism. Obviously, the climate deniers, but even on the left, that there's going to be some techno fix. There's going to be some billionaire that's going to come up with something that's going to save us, or, you know, whatever. Instead of just accepting the fact that we're in the sixth mass extinction, special extinction is happening at 1,000 times greater than the normal background rate. We're losing between 150 and 200 different species every single day. And the odds are certainly today looking like we may well be on the way out ourselves as a species. And you have to process through a whole lot of feelings to get finally down to acceptance that, yeah, okay, you know, well, it's obvious. We all know we're all going to die at some point, but accepting the fact that it might be sooner than we think and then coming to peace with that. But in so doing, it really revelatizes or highlights like this moment. We have this now. You know, kind of like we were talking about earlier, we can still go be out in nature. We can still go be on a glacier. We can still go be in a beautiful, untouched forest. And you know, let's do that. You know, we still can do that today. And that becomes that much more exquisite when we know that those systems might not be there in just a few years. You know, so it's really bringing that death awareness into everything. And not that I'm walking around thinking about death all the time, but once you really accept it, then, you know, the gratitude for being alive and being able to be out in nature today is that much more profound, I think.
I was just thinking, this just came to my mind, it's a strange thought, but you know, there's this, it's almost a cliche, but this idea that, you know, we come from the natural world, we are a part of this universe, we are able to perceive, we're conscious beings, we're able to see and experience the universe. And we are the universe itself, right? So we're kind of observing ourselves, if that makes any kind of sense, because everything is interconnected, right? So when you kind of let that sink in, and you know that everything is changing, like we're seeing, as a result of a sick culture, I would say, right? The value systems of a sick culture.
Very sick culture.
Very sick. And, you know, there's a whole historical process that we could probably spend another couple hours talking about. We don't have to do that. That's not important right now. but like when that sinks in, you think, well, then how would I in this time be the most grateful for what nature has allowed us, has given us to observe and to be a part of? Which is strange to think about, because if everything is being wasted, obviously we took a wrong turn somewhere, I guess, collectively. But for those of us that are watching this interview, that are participating in it right now, that are coming into this information, and you think, well, what the hell do I do? There's not an easy answer. Everybody's going to have their own way of coming about it. For me, it was doing all this stuff, you know, that we're doing now. But thinking like, what is the most beautiful way that we could possibly experience this time that we're in? And it's by, you know, being as present as possible. And this is where it gets tricky, because again, we still have to exist in this paradigm that we're in. We're still going to drive our car. I still have to go to my job. When we go back to my hometown, go back to work and deal with stupid customers again. No offense to those people, but whatever. I have to do that. I have to do the thing. And for me, that, Rob, that's the most challenging thing. I mean, yeah, we're in a capitalist economy. We're specialized. We all have these skills sets made specifically to serve certain interests that are not about living beautifully, that are not about connection. And I have a really hard time with that. It comes in waves. And I think that to me is the most difficult thing for me personally, is like, I want to get away from all that in the time that we have. I want to live as beautifully as I can with my wife, with my family, with my, you know, be outside. And I'm not doing very well at that right now, considering how busy I am with this project all the time. And I think about how ironic and twisted that is. By my concern about these things, I'm actually not doing the things that I'm recommending people do.
But most of us are in that situation. I mean, right now with a book out, being on tour, and working full time for Truthout, I'm in that situation. And I'd certainly rather be up in the mountains and live happily ever after, you know, and just go from trip to trip to trip. And I talk to the people closest to me saying that often, yet this is also how I serve the earth. And so that means I need to go out and talk and do this work and get this information out and keep kind of doing my part in helping evolve consciousness as much as possible. And the reality is that the vast majority, I mean, how many people do we know that have enough money or are so situated that they could just completely unplug? And the reality is most of us have to live at least with one foot in the system, if not both. But I think it's not about just having gratitude for what's here. Like that's a very nice feeling, but it's that gratitude necessitates action, and it necessitates paying it forward, and it necessitates service, mm-hmm. I think, and mm-hmm. service to other people. And, you know, it's not about just, okay, I need to get this information out there, but living in this new time and being of service to the planet, I think for everyone means everybody doing what you're already doing in a sense, because mm-hmm. we need healers, we need gardeners, we need people serving at restaurants so that people can eat. We need, you know, I mean, we need people doing what seemingly might appear to be some of the most mundane work, but it takes everybody doing what they're doing, mm-hmm. you know? And I think simultaneous to this collapse time, this era of loss that we're in, there is this enlightenment and there is this kind of growing up of consciousness that I'm seeing it all over the place. I mean, we wouldn't be having this conversation mm-hmm. if it wasn't happening. And I think a lot of the people watching this are already there too.
I think something as simple that I see both of you do that I admire is just a shift in priorities. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. you've shifted your priorities to doing a radio show mm-hmm. and putting yourself out there. You shifted your priorities and dropping everything that you've done and have just dived into what this climate crisis is all about. I think that's something to be applauded. And yes, we still have to have one foot in the system when we do that. And I think what makes it hard to communicate with people, what made it hard for me to process this was I thought about the things I did with my life, how I screwed up. And I wish I would have taken some moments back. Like I was in Peru and I was looking at the Andes Mountains and I didn't realize that that was goodbye, probably. I'll never see snow caps on the mountains again. And I wish I would have pictured that. And I think reading your book's going to help me process how to do those moments better. But it also I think a problem too is with people is I still have all these things I want to do. And you're telling me I may not be able to get to do these things anymore. It's a very internal introspection at first.
Yeah. There was a concept, an idea that Charles Eisenstein has brought up, which is that we tend to think of cause and effect in a very kind of Newtonian way. Like you do one thing and it creates an effect, obviously, right? Very, very basic thing. But he was kind of pointing to how the it was like the matrix of causality is not how we always perceive it to be, which is to say that the smallest, most beautiful actions that don't seem important on this global scale are actually just as important as the people out there protesting or out there trying to make massive global changes. So why, you know, it is just as important, if not more important, to take care of your dying mother, you know, and being with her in her last moments. While that sacred, that moment is sacred and that moment is important for you and for her, that doesn't mean it's any less than someone going out and doing this big political thing, you know, fighting the state, fighting capitalism, you know, trying to stop global warming from destroying everything, right? Like, we think that the bigger the action is, the more important it is. And I think especially considering the state of things, you really have to ask, like, is that really the most important thing you could be doing right now? It's not to say it's not important. It's just that we need to reframe our understanding of what is sacred and what's valuable. Again, in the context of what you've presented and other people have presented regarding abrupt climate disruption. And I think that that's what I've been really had to reassess my position in my life. Like, you know, getting, you know, so invested and almost obsessed with researching, finding new people, doing all this stuff, trying to bring this awareness and trying to get this podcast to be bigger or whatever, you know, it's not about that. You know, people are going to be attracted to this information if they're already there. You know, I had this, I'm not going to talk about it. I had this thing with a guy and I realized at this point, like, why did I talk to this person? Why did I give him the time of day? It's not about trying to convince people anymore. It's like the information is there. If people want to see it, they can. If not, I can't do anything for you. Find those that matter to you and invest your love and your time into that. Mm-hmm. And I think that's, if anything, when you talk to these scientists in this book, you know, when you did your talk last night, that was what was really profound, is that they are very objective people. They're looking at the objective evidence, but they love what they're studying. Mm-hmm. The gentleman, I can't remember his name, that was in the Amazon.
Dr. Thomas Lovejoy.
Yeah, he loves the forest. He loves it, like, deeply. He was called to that place. Mm-hmm. But he's researching it, and he's bringing this information to light, too. And that, to me, is like, that's what it should be about. And
well, his love expressed itself in founding these different camps. Mm-hmm. In the one camp I went to, Camp 41, which is the most famous of, I think it's at least seven of them, mm-hmm. that one camp alone has produced over 700 published peer-reviewed scientific studies.
Wow.
That's his expression yeah. of that love. And I think that's a model for all of us that, I love this place, whatever it is. I have this gratitude to get to experience it. Now, how am I going to show that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you show that in the book, right? That's one thing that I found so interesting in your talk last night is I figure a lot of people that are going to be talking to you are going to be talking to you about glaciers, sea level rise. But the fact that you were in that camp and you felt like you became the forest, could you tell us a little bit more about that experience?
Yeah, that was actually the first time in public last night at my reading at Powell's that I talked about that. And I'm actually really glad that was a powerful and meaningful talk for me. And it was also taped for alternative radio, so it will air. And I'm grateful for that, because being in the Amazon, I've had a kind of a similar experience, but different in the mountains with them. But in the Amazon, I'd never been there. And we lived in this open air camp. There's no walls. You sleep in a hammock with a mosquito net underneath a little tin roof. And you know, the people there visiting the camp, everyone's just lined up in their hammocks. And you eat meals together at these picnic tables. And then you go on these jungle walks and you get to talk to these scientists. And so you really start having an intimate relationship with this place. And the most amazing thing happened was all these people from all over the world, I knew one of these people going there. The Barbara, who helped me work on and edit the book, came with me and actually helped arrange the whole trip. And aside from her, I didn't know anyone else. And by the end of just a few days together in this place, like, we were all completely integrated. And we were laughing and telling stories and listening to each other and learning. And, I mean, it was amazing because actually the last evening we were there, the last full night, we'd had this wonderful dinner with everyone. And it's interesting because not that long before that, Barbara and I had been in a situation on the West Coast in a group of a bunch of people. And it was, there was like this kind of hyper identity politic fracturing that happened, and everybody turned against each other, and it created an extremely challenging, difficult situation. And unfortunately, it was expressed through a lot of the youth. And conversely, being in the Amazon, and there was a lot of young people in this group, and instead of kind of a disrespect and an anger at older generations and things like we had experienced at this place on the West Coast, there was this gratitude. And literally this young, I believe it was a 19-year-old boy from France, stood up and just thanked all of the older generations for doing things like preserving parts of the Amazon and doing our environmental work and awareness raising, and thanked everybody for all the work that we were doing. And then that expression really kind of washed over the whole camp. And it made all of us feel that much closer. And what I really realized today was it was really the Amazon working through us. Because what was happening from the first night I got there was it came into my dreams, and I was having these really amazing, profound dreams and waking up at night and thinking about them and hearing the birds, and then in the early first light, hearing the howler monkeys' roars coming through camp, and you know, all of these experiences together, it literally felt like the jungle was literally coming into my being and kind of pulling me deeper into it, because that's where we're all from. And it literally started living through us, as expressed by this young man's gratitude for everyone. And literally another example was this tarantula walks into camp. And several of these scientists, one of them, Vitek, who's in my book, they're all like amazed at, you know, we just watch them, like, they're amazed at this tarantula and shining lights and, oh, where did it come from? And okay, let's pick it up and go put it back in the jungle. And everyone was looking at it and, you know, identifying its species and, you know, and all of this, and just this joy and fascination at life. Because, you know, what other place can you go to where there's as much biodiversity and just raw life energy just coming up and out of everything? And that was the experience being there. And I tried my best to convey that in the book and convey Dr. Thomas Lovejoy's love and experience of the same thing, because, you know, really that, you know, to some degree of that, if we really immerse ourselves in nature, I think anyone can really experience that if we open ourselves up to it.
Let me ask you this. That's interesting. You talk about it's almost like the well, obviously the Amazon forest had its own life force, its own swirling energy that you were pulled into, and yeah, inevitably it impacted how you slept, your dreams, all of that. It probably impacted everybody's behavior and how they treated one another. And you've been on, you know, you've been to many different, you know, glaciers, mountains. You I'm sure you recognize, obviously you'd recognize that each place has its own, you know, like you talk about the Amazon forest pulling you in and giving, you know, affecting you on this deeper level. Can you kind of like comment on all these places that you visited, from the coral reefs to the mountains that you summited to the Amazon forest, to all these different places you've been? Each place has its own energy, its own spirit about it. I just think that's really fascinating. You know, that's a fascinating idea. And that's part of the, you know, saying goodbye to these places. It's really tragic because, you know, indigenous cultures that have respected and understood these places recognize that spirit to each of these places. And that's why each indigenous culture, of course, is so profoundly unique, because they represent the place that they are a part of, the land that they are with.
This is why one of the quotes I lead the book with before I actually even start the introduction is a Wendell Berry quote where he says, there are no unsacred places. There are sacred places and desecrated places.
Yeah. Yeah. I guess I could just ask if, you know, you talk about the Amazon, but what is it like for you? Cause you're always drawn, you know, as somebody who's been to so many different glaciers, mountains, what is it about mountains in particular? I don't know if you could possibly articulate that feeling, but I'm sure that you have that unique something that comes from being on the top of a mountain. I mean, what is that? Could you possibly, because I haven't done that. I haven't climbed any mountains, so I can't speak from any personal experience, but what is that like for you?
Really, just being in the mountains, because it's such a ridiculously minuscule percentage of the time in mountains is actually on a summit. But it's really just being in them and being within them. And to me, it feels like being in church. I mean, that is my church. And it's the perspective I have of how long they've been there, how long they're going to be there. And I'm just this instantaneous flash. There's being humbled by how big they are and how much power is there within them, and the energy up in these regions, especially on the bigger mountains. And really it's just, I think, a very, very easy place for me to remember my place in nature, that I'm just this tiny little being, this little speck, but also am there to experience it and appreciate it. And the same thing, like my thinking changes when I'm up there, my dreams, I have clearer dreams. If I am needing clarity in some part of my life, I inevitably get it when I'm up there. Not because I'm searching for it, but just because by placing myself up there and out there, it comes. Mm-hmm. And then there's, of course, the obvious getting up higher on a mountain and summiting and being able to look out. And if it's a very, very big mountain, being able to kind of look down and see everything lower, there is that obvious perspective that comes with that, kind of a more global view on everything. And mm-hmm. and it just kind of helps me, it integrates kind of right place of myself and everything in the world in a way that I think I don't get anywhere else. But like you said, it's impossible to really describe. And I think other people, like I've met plenty of people that going into the ocean is their church, or forests, or the desert Southwest, or, you know, pick your place, or even a stream, or maybe even it's just a city park, but it's going to be different for everybody. Mm-hmm. And everybody's going to have our own unique experience with it. But, it is sacred to me. And it is a big component of my own personal spirituality of just really, that's the easiest place for me to go and really connect back in with the earth / myself.
Yeah. Yeah. I wanted to ask more directly political questions towards the end of this. Is that okay? That I kind of shift gears a little bit? you know, while doing this is what's so, I think, amazing about while you're doing this book and you're writing and discussing some of these very profound topics, you're also still writing about like the Trump administration and policies that they're trying to push through. And, you know, it must be also obviously very emotional to research these things and to realize where we're at. So I guess maybe there were two major points that I wanted to bring up. And the first one is that we're in the midst of a partial government shutdown right now. And, you know, the stated reason is that Trump wants this border wall funded and he's mad that it's not being funded. And so he's like, we're going to shut down some of these government, you know, administrations and stuff. But you wrote an article for Truthout just this month, I believe. It came out this month. It's called Despite Shutdown, Trump is Pushing Forward Plans to Drill in Arctic. And I just want to quote this really quick, and then I want to ask a little bit about that. In April 2018, the Trump administration took the first step toward oil and gas drilling in the wildlife refuge by officially launching a 60-day review process for holding a lease sale in the pristine area. Since then, the administration has worked consistently toward opening the wildlife refuge to drilling, even despite the government shutdown that Trump himself caused. Opponents of the efforts to push drilling forward have criticized the move, pointing out how obvious the contrast is between this and the lack of staffing at the national parks, that is leading to overflowing garbage, vandalism, and unattended public toilets. Bridget Bessarianos, I hope I'm saying that correctly, a staff attorney with the nonprofit public interest environmental law firm Trustees for Alaska, told Alaska Public Media that it is, quote, unusual behavior for the Bureau of Land Management to move forward with public meetings despite a government shutdown. What is going on with that particular story? If you could illuminate us a little bit.
Well, the overall component of it is that the Bureau of Land Management, which is under the Department of Interior, has been allowed to carry forward with holding public meetings to keep the process of opening the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge to drilling on track. So this so-called partial government shutdown, obviously from its advent, has been nothing more than a political tool.
Sure.
And the whole thing's been invented by this administration. And I think it's just another indication of the absolute in-game insanity of this culture that is, by design, eating the entire planet and itself along the way. It's utter, pure insanity. The opening the Arctic to drill at this stage of the game, in the context of everything that we've just talked about, is mind-bendingly insane. And you know, having this this infant as a president, this child who really is actually the absolute perfect symbol of the end stage of what this system produces, a entitled, infantilized, narcissistic, completely incapable of functioning on its own resources being. It's really mind-bending, but it's also the absolute perfect symbol. That is really what this culture produces. This dominant, sick, runaway corporate capitalist, global corporate capitalist culture. Donald Trump is the epitome. He is the face of it in such a perfect way. And that, against the backdrop of the possibility of even our own species going extinct, that we're still going to keep pushing forward with doing the exact thing that is causing that very extinction. I mean, it really is in that way a perfect symbol of, you know, if we stick with this culture, this is what happens.
But what's frightening me is we're seeing this more around the world, is Bolsonaro now declaring war on the Amazon rainforest. And with it would also go some of the last uncontacted tribes in the world. What knowledge we could lose from that is terrifying to me. You have Vladimir Putin, who has been quoted as saying that climate change is happening, but it's not man-made. So what do you see when you are reading these reports and you see this new rise in authoritarianism, especially on the right side? Mm-hmm. How do you look at all that?
Yeah, and even in Western governments, one third of all Western governments now are either already going into authoritarianism. I would argue that this country is one that is in authoritarianism. I mean, a lot of people still think there's enough functioning institutions, but given the hundreds of federal judges that are now extreme right wing, given the Supreme Court is now gone, and other factors at play, I would argue that this country is already authoritarian and is heading towards totalitarianism, possibly. Numerous others, you just pointed out Brazil, and that's just the West. So if a third of the Western countries, which, you know, in theory, this is the so-called free world, not even to talk about these other countries that have always had authoritarians or totalitarians around the world, and we know what those are. So it is, in that sense, and of course, all of these people's perspective on the environment is just that it's this resource to use and we're going to deny climate change, et cetera, et cetera. It is, I think, another symptom of the grim nature of these times. And it really underscores the importance of all of ours coming to terms with loss, with death, with our own deaths, and the imperativeness to find out what can I do to work for the planet. And the onus is really on us. It also underscores that anyone thinking that, well, we can wait for an election or we're going to turn the steerage of this government around, there's just no time for that kind of thing.
So I have a selfish question that I've always wanted to ask you. And now that I have this moment, I'm going to be a little selfish and ask it.
Go for it.
Because I think maybe this ties into this a little bit is when you went to Iraq and you went, you said you did like what, 10 or 13 trips, I think it was. And
10.
Yeah. And you saw the systems that we rely on failing over there. Does that give you a different perspective on what's happening and what the future may hold when you witness some of these things over there?
I feel like I've gotten a glimpse of the future of this country by seeing what was happening there and what's happening in a lot of other countries already around the world where the government had collapsed. The government existed only to keep itself in power. It hit a point where it does little to nothing, if anything, sometimes for the Iraqi people. So, I mean, they couldn't even take the garbage out in Baghdad, the capital city of the country. Power, you know, maybe 1 to 4 hours of electricity per day, food, you know, potable water, electricity, you know, these things. So what I saw was communities basically were forced and to rely upon themselves. And mosques became organizing centers where they would orchestrate, okay, how can we figure out medical care? Who has electrical generators? How can we run that? You know, and they became these centers of organization, and actually life then went on in a lot of these neighborhoods in the capital city. How do we figure out security, et cetera, et cetera? So in that way, there were kind of these small shining examples of, well, here's what people left to their own devices are going to do to take care of themselves. And in the war zone, I got to see in times of crisis, yeah, there are horrible things that come out. There's barbarism, there's looting, there's people being taken advantage of in the worst ways. But far more often, there's acts of deep humanity and love and kindness. And I saw people taking families into their homes that they had no idea who these people were. They just knew that they needed shelter, and giving them food and giving them money and helping them however that they could. And I hope that, and I see a lot of that already happening in this country. And I hope that going forward, as things intensify, that becomes more the norm. And there absolutely will be breakdown in violence and polarization, as we're seeing in the news every single day, as people turn against each other. But simultaneously, certainly within the small community where I live, we're working towards the opposite of that. That we're tight, we're growing food together, we're sharing skills, and we're getting together regularly and trying to deepen all those connections. And so, as we do with the earth, inshallah, using the word that I learned in Iraq, we would do that with each other too.
Yeah, I think for people that are watching this or listening to this, I think that's the important work is like, yes, there's going to be systemic. We're seeing our country, whatever that concept is.
Collapse. We are in collapse in this country. Yeah. And if anyone doesn't understand that now, then stay tuned.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think that's what's the component of it, is that when we do talk about these concepts like abrupt climate disruption, it's not that it's left out, but we assume for some reason that what's happening politically is somehow separate from what's happening in the climate. I mean, it just sort of happens. We don't necessarily mean to do that. It just does. But those are so, they're like this. They're mm-hmm. The one cannot happen without the other. You know, I think you've mentioned this in maybe a previous interview, the military-industrial complex is one of the biggest CO2 emitters in the world. Mm-hmm. So that is directly contributing to the crises that we're in the midst of right now. And again, as things begin to fall apart, and this is the thing about the government shutdown that I find disturbing, is I feel like it's being used, like you said, as a political tool to obscure certain things that are happening. So people are distracted. It's kind of like whenever the presidential election cycle begins, which is already starting. It's a red herring. It's actually really frustrating now that they're already coming up with presidential candidates, just because it throws people off. People forget that real political action happens outside of the election, the voting booth. That's really inconsequential at this point. Mm-hmm. And trying to articulate that to some people is very difficult, because there's so much gravity that it pulls people in and it distracts people away from what's happening. But anyway, talking about the government shutdown, this is a symptom of a collapse. Mm-hmm. You know, this is a part of a bigger trend. And in the midst of climate change, all of this is coming down. We need to build communities like you're doing. We need to find that connection with other people. We need to learn also to say goodbye to these beautiful places that we love. And all of this, this is by far, I don't know what I'm trying to say. It's just incredible. This is just a very difficult time.
It is. It's going to be the single most challenging time for this species, for our species, ever. I mean, there's no question about that, and it's going to intensify. And you know, we are going to be living through catastrophic impacts of runaway climate change, without a doubt. We already are, and it's going to intensify. And you know, this is at 1.1°C. And as I talked about last night, you know, we have projections from very, very conservative entities like BP and Shell's analysts to the International Energy Agency that are saying between 5 and 6°C could be possible before 2050. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is lunacy. I mean, this is, if people understand, I mean, for example, I remember talking in the Amazon at Camp 41 with Lovejoy, and I was talking about, well, hey, this and this and this projection are looking at 3, 4, 5, or even 6°C by 2100. And he got very angry and he cut me off and he said, people don't even understand what it means to go to 2°C. Mm-hmm. And there was this gravity in how he said that. And I read last night some of these impacts just from 2°C. And so when we talk about 4, 5, 6°C, like, we absolutely are talking about, it's really hard for me to see that humans don't go extinct at that. And if those projections are accurate, that means 30 years. Mm-hmm. And that's the time that we're living in. And then there's this political insanity happening. And in a sense, it kind of makes sense that that would happen. Yeah. Because if you're not deeply related and tapped into the earth and staying sane and staying centered and hanging out with other people trying to do the same thing, you are going to go insane. Because look at what's happening to the planet and look at the response of governments. It's pure, utter insanity. And there's no, and I mean that literally. Yeah. I'm not being flippant at all. And so I think it leaves us each with a choice, you know, what world do I want to live in? And I want to be in the real. Yeah. I mean, Martin Luther King said not that long before he died that, you know, any country that puts militarism, I'm paraphrasing his quote, but that puts militarism ahead of social welfare programs is approaching spiritual death. He said that over 50 years ago now. And this country, I would argue, is largely spiritually dead. And this is why you have an individual as president that literally epitomizes that. You know, zero morality, zero integrity, zero dignity. The only God is money and power. Mm-hmm. And that is this country. And, you know, people that criticize Trump, how many of your decisions are you making based solely on money?
Yeah,
you know, I mean, each of us now, it's a time to do some serious introspection and get really, really clear about what's really important.
Yeah. Rob, do you have any, before we wrap this whole thing up, we've been talking a little over an hour, so I think it's fair that we touched on everything that we both wanted to get to. Is there anything else that you would like to say before we kind of give more information about where to find out about Dahr's book?
Just thank you. Thank you for taking the time and talking to us. It's surreal to talk to two people that I have tremendous respect for. I look at you like somebody that's a hero of mine. So I appreciate you taking that time out.
Well, it's a real pleasure to get to have this conversation with you guys. And, you know, this is the kind of discussion and thinking and openness that if this was a more healthy functioning democracy would be, you know, a nationally televised talk show, you know, instead of the crap that is nationally televised, because this is what's real. And I'm just really grateful for the opportunity to have a conversation like this and get it out to some more folks, and that to know that you guys are both out there doing the job too.
Yeah. Well, Dahr, I'm really glad that we had this chance. You know, I mentioned this, it's surreal, but it's an incredibly beautiful thing to finally meet you. I do also admire your work and you as a human being. So I really sincerely thank you so much for helping work this plan out. We could finally meet, and it was It's been a beautiful experience. I thank you so much.
Well, it's mutual. Thanks so much to both you guys.
Let me just show this book. Hey, people buy this book, The End of Ice, Bearing Witness and Finding Meaning in the Path of Climate Disruption by this amazing human being right here, Dahr Jamail. You, of course, you write for Truthout. You still, even in the midst of your book tour, you're releasing regular reports for Truthout. So people, I will put links to his book where you can purchase it. I imagine it's going to be at every major bookstore, independent or otherwise. You could buy it online on Amazon. I wouldn't recommend it, but you can get it from the publisher, I'm sure. You can go to the publisher's website. I'll put a link to that down in the description of this episode. Rob and I, like I think we may have mentioned, we're doing a joint release, so we're going to have it on his show moving forward on PRN. It's going to be on, of course, my podcast, Last Born in the Wilderness. And I have nothing else to say except thank you again, Dahr. I really greatly appreciate this experience.
Thanks, you guys.
Thank you.
Okay. Hey, thanks for making your way through this interview, this discussion with Rob Symetz and Dahr Jamail. As we mentioned at the beginning, this is a joint release for my show, Last Born in the Wilderness, and for Rob's show on PRN moving forward. So please go subscribe to Rob's show. It's an amazing show. He has fantastic guests on his show. So please go support Rob and his work. And of course, if you want to know anything about Dahr's work, go to his website, dahrjamail.net. Everything that I'm going to mention is going to be down in the description of this episode. So go check out his website. You'll find everything you need to know about his work there. He writes regularly for Truthout. And he also, of course, having just published this book, The End of Ice, is going on a book tour. So you'll find out more information, I believe, by going to his website, dahrjamail.net, to know more about where he's going to be speaking, doing book signings, and all of that. So I just want to say really quickly, I just want to thank everybody that supported this work up to this point. This is a new thing for this podcast. So thank you for supporting it. Thank you for sharing these episodes, for giving me feedback, and especially those that have been supporting this work on Patreon. If you would like to support this work on Patreon, you can do so at the website patreon.com/lastborninthewilderness. You go to that website, you can make very small monthly contributions to the production of this podcast. You can do as little as $1 a month, and by doing that, you'll gain early access to these episodes, these conversations that I inevitably release publicly, but I give to the patrons a little bit in advance. So I just want to thank my patrons, especially for supporting me, supporting this work. Please go support my work by going down to the description. You'll find a link to the one-time donation page as well as the Patreon page. So yeah, go subscribe to Rob's podcast. It's an amazing show. Support Dahr Jamail by going to Truthout, reading his regular climate dispatches and other reports that he does there, and go buy his book, The End of Ice, which is at every major bookseller, and of course from the publisher's website, which I have all of these things down in the description of this episode again, so please go check that out. Thank you for watching this discussion with Rob Symetz and Dahr Jamail.